All right. So good morning. We can swiftly continue till the next topics. And before doing that, of course, I do my usual little summary about what we covered in the past lecture. And as you have seen, we basically got to know about the tangent space. We got to know about manifolds. And we have seen how to build up mathematical structures that can be used to deal with chord spaces. And therefore also with any kind of arbitrary transformation, also that are nonlinear. At the end, we derived the definition of a vector as the as based on the directional derivative of a scalar field along a curve. So we define a path given one point in our manifold. We define our path crossing this point, and we define a scalar function which is arbitrary, and we looked at how this scalar function is changing along the path. And as we have seen, we constructed a vector. We have seen that directional derivatives are objects that obey all rules that vectors must obey, meaning their linear combination must still be a vector, such that the sum of two vectors is still a vector, such that if you have a vector you multiply by a scalar, it's still a vector. So directional derivatives obey this rule, plus we have also the zero element, because we can have a zero vector that basically when we make through the sum give us the same vector to which it is summed in first place. And we arrived at this construction in which we managed to identify a vector with its component and a basis. Okay? If we could just change the name of these symbols, you see that we have the same structure that we have before for our basis set, for the construction of a vector as a linear combination of bases. And you have seen that we managed to arrive at that because we started from a manifold in which is just a collection of points, and through the chart, that then through charts, actually plural, because we made have a collection of charts that we can group together to create an atlas, we managed to create a homomorphism, is basically mapping our manifold, our points in the manifold, into Rn, where n is the number, is the dimension of our manifold. And once we have this sort of mapping, we can define derivatives that allow us to create this construction. And we have seen that the collection of these points constitute the tangent space. This is our tangent space. And we have seen that we can write it as TP, because this is the collection of vectors, of all possible vectors, living in a point on a manifold. Okay? Again, vectors are not something that goes from here to there, but they are objects that exist in one point. And this is the collection of the vectors. If we want to be more generic, we can say we have a manifold, we select a point, and we get the tangent space. We are not using this construction because we are going basically to deal only with one manifold, which describes our space-time, and this is kind of accessory. Okay, so we can just write in a simpler way like that. Good. And these vectors obey all the transformation rules that we have already studied, because we have seen that we can always find a transformation that can make basically our in that point we can make a transformation such that in that point all rules that vectors obey for flat space hold. Okay? And it is, you know, is flat in P. Okay? And you know that because it has also a very strong physical meaning, because if we have a free-falling object, like this choke, you know that I can define a transformation for this very precise point in which the choke is falling, which is accelerated downward. So I have a non-linear transformation, and as we've seen with the bottle, in this point, in this frame falling, there is no gravity, there is no gravitational field, the particle, the water in the bottle, as we've seen, behaves as in Minkowski space, doesn't feel any gravity. And you understand that we can play this trick in all points in our manifold, but for each point need its own transformation. You cannot define a transformation that can achieve G equal to nu everywhere. Okay? Because if we are here, I let the choke fall, I can define my accelerated frames going this direction with the very precise acceleration that gravity has in this precise point. But if we go on the other side of the Earth, the acceleration is going to be directed in the opposite direction, and my accelerated frame would brutally fail on the other side. For the other side of the Earth, or even other location away from this point, I different transformation such to achieve the flatness, let's say, in that location, such that we could, from a generic metric, recover a Minkowski metric. Now I'm a little bit not very properly speaking about metric, because up to this point we never introduced the metric. Right? In this derivation, where was the metric? So far, no metric was introduced. Therefore, the next step that we have to do, now I don't remember the number, it's 5. Step 5 in our multi-layer mathematical construction, which we are putting together all the pieces to deal with the problem ahead, is that we need to induce a metric. On the manifold. And this is needed because, for example, we want to measure distances. We want to measure volumes. We want to know what is the modulus of a vector. And so on, all the things that we could do in Minkowski space when we introduced a metric. And which kind of metric we would like to have? Well, we don't know. The metric in general is going to depend on the particular configuration of energy, matter and energy that we have across our universe, because they are going to be the source of our gravitational field, and they are going to be the source of the distortion of the space-time. Okay? At this point, we don't know how to do it, but we know that locally, for each point P, we can define we know that we must have flat geometry because the falling bottle, the water inside that bottle, didn't feel any presence of a distorted space-time because it didn't feel any gravity. And therefore, in that bottle, all rules about special relativity must obey, must be there, okay? Must be fulfilled. And here, now I can speak about a Minkowski metric, not before, because at that point we still hadn't. I wanted to give you the information first, but to be rigorous, now we can speak about a Minkowski metric. Okay? So from G, we can always make a transformation such that in a point P, we can get our Minkowski metric. Okay? And just reinforcing what I said before. Nothing new to you at this point. Now, that's mathematics, and from this you understand that the metric now depends on positions on the space-time. It's not the same everywhere. And we introduce it because this metric is kind of going to play the role of the potential in Newtonian mechanics. Okay? It's not a potential because it has a different meaning. But you will see that it's going to have the same role of the gravitational potential when we're going to derive the equation of motion of particles in a gravitational field. Okay, or particles in a distorted space-time, in a curved space-time. Now, what is the physical meaning? You know, we are physicists, we apply approximations, and already at this point I would like to attach a physical meaning because now we are just talking about manifolds, vectors, and this sort of stuff, so there's no physics there. And you know that we need to do something, some approximation, to describe even the water without our bottle, because if this was the bottle, the potential here is different from here. This point of the manifold is not this point of the manifold. But you know that on this scale, nobody could ever measure the difference in the acceleration of this point with respect to this one, right? If we would have a gigantic bottle from here to 3 kilometers high up, then yes, the acceleration at the bottom of the bottle would be different than the one at the top of the bottle, and this non-inertial difference would be perceivable, and one could spot the presence of gravity. Okay? Therefore, locally, we can do that. Now, let's make a visual trick in which we are embedding our manifold in a larger dimensional space, and we can take a point P on the manifold, and now you understand that the space locally around P is going to be flat in the vicinity of the manifold. Okay, so within a certain range, the metric at first order can be approximated as Minkowski. If we take another point on the manifold, you know, the space-time is kind of curved in this way, we would get a different, oof, I don't know how to do it, let's make it more curved. Or let's take a point here, and the tangent to the surface of this of our manifold would be oriented in a different way with respect to the other bit. Okay, so for another point Q, not P, but Q, we have a different tangent space, as we have seen. This is a way of visualizing. Now, what we want to do is basically saying that, okay, we want our metric, G, alpha, beta, these are the coefficients, in a sum position P, this is going to be at first order Minkowski. I can do that. I can apply the transformation to have it Minkowski in exactly that position, alpha and beta. Then what I want? I want that the first order, G alpha beta comma, so that's the derivative of gamma in that point is equal to zero. At first order, we are flat. If we go to higher order, we would make a Taylor expansion of our metric, we would have the zeroth order, first order, and then we can go at higher orders, where we have the coefficient g alpha beta, and then we have a double derivative with respect to gamma and, again, at the position p, and now this could be different than zero. Okay, therefore we have Minkowski at first order, and then we have this term which is different than zero, which is responsible for tidal forces. Something which would be perceived as a tidal force. As we said, there are no forces in play here, but this is something that would be perceived as a tidal force, which is what? A sort of stretching. Because if this is the Earth, we have a point here, we have a point here, very far away, then the acceleration here is going to be larger with respect to the one here. Therefore, we have this sort of stretching, right? And this stretching is this tidal force. Now, how we write that? Well, we have just that our metric, after the transformation, we just get the G prime such that we have the Minkowski metric at first order, G alpha beta, in some position X, is going to be equal to what? The Minkowski metric, nu mu, and plus a big O of that depends on the square of the separation of the point with respect to the reference point P that we took. Okay, that's what we can achieve. And you can do that because G is symmetric. Which means that G alpha beta, mu beta, I said alpha, let's do 2 alpha, is equal to G beta alpha. So a diagonal metric, I can a symmetric metric, I can always diagonalize it. That's why I can achieve this. Okay? Then maybe the coefficients are not going to be minus 1, 1, 1, 1, and maybe it's minus 2, 3, 7, or whatever, but I have the freedom to rescale, to find the eigenvalues of those matrix, rescale it, such that each line then is normalized to minus 1, 1, 1, 1, and 1. And I get exactly the Minkowski metric. Okay? Now, how can I be sure that I can do this approximation? Well, this depends on the space-time, on the curvature of the space-time. Now, we'll not be rigorous because we will define the curvature in a most rigorous way. But I can already tell you that we can define a curvature radius. And if you think of the sphere that I introduced in the example that I gave you, you understand that it's something related to L, right? That's why we speak about radius, it tells you how the manifold is curved. Because if I take a gigantic sphere, okay, let's take the Earth, that's flat locally because R is super long. Therefore, given the same length, like between my fingers, here you can see the curvature, here you cannot. Okay? Therefore, what one does is to introduce a curvature which is related to the second derivatives of the metric. Why second derivatives? Because it's related to that. Of course, not at the first order, you need to go at higher order. And as a definition, we define the curvature radius at the power of 2 in some position P as, it's a positive number, so we just use the absolute value of the G and then the square x. Okay? That's the idea. And of course, you have the radius, which is going to be equal, so the radius in a position P is going to be equal to the square of g over the square x square root. Okay, that's the curvature radius. And you understand that you can define it for every point on the manifold, because the metric is going to be defined on any point on the manifold. And you see that if R is going to infinite, it means that this guy is going to zero, and we are in this condition. This is negligible. We have only the terms of first order. Okay? Now let's take our elevator, or the bottle, or whatever you want to use. And let's take, now it is just a graphical representation, let's say that the curvature here is very high. Is very high. Something like that. Okay? So we have the size of the width of our elevator, and the curvature, second derivatives, here is very high. Here it's not. You see, there is no curvature. Also, when you do functional analysis, you look at the second order derivatives to look what is the curvature of your function. Here we are doing the same, if you wish, okay, for the manifold. You understand that in this location, given this width, we have a high curvature and the approximation breaks. Same elevator with the same width, but now the curvature is very little. Okay, so here we have kind of a very high curvature, very small curvature radius. Here we have a, well, it's not very clear, so let's say that this is our, the curvature describes as a graphical representation of the curvature of our associated to the point P. In this case, same width, but the curvature, the curvature radius is very large, so we have this sort of situation, and we basically have a very good representation. Our elevator is small, but you we think it's small is always small with respect to something else. Okay? If we are in the proximity of a black hole, this is this size, I mean literally this size is too large. Might be too large. Okay, tidal forces on this length in the proximity of a black hole, where the second derivative terms are very high, therefore the curvature of space-time is very high, then this approximation is broken. Okay, so you don't think all is small like this or like that. It depends on your space-time as well. Good. Now we know how to deal with individual points on the manifold. But how can we connect the different points? How are they related one with each other? We need another bit of mathematics. That one was 5, so we are at the infrastructure point number 6, and we need an affine connection. On top of which, we can define covariant derivatives. So, what's happened? We have a point P, we have a point Q, we have a tangent space associated to this point, and we have a tangent space associated to this other point. Fantastic. Individually, we know exactly what to do for each point. But if we have something that is moving from here to there, how do we deal with that? We don't know. And the problem, as we have seen, is that, let's say we have some manifold, the basis in this location are not the same basis from this location. And from the very definition of a vector space, you know that a vector W belongs to some vector space, let's say to the tangent space P, is a vector if a sum of other two vectors of the tangent space give the guy, right? But if we have a point here and a point here and they belong to different vector spaces, how can you do that? How can you sum up even vectors? How can you define a good definition of derivatives when you change from one point to another and the bases are changing under your feet? Okay? So that's what we are trying to do now. We are trying to find a connection. And the fact that the bases are changing with respect to position is reflected in the derivative, because we have seen that with the standard partial derivative, so we are aiming at that point. Here we need this connection. That's why we need some structure that allows us to do that. Then we have a problem with partial derivative because of this very same reason that we see there. Don't obey anymore very well with what we need to construct a fully covariant theory. Because we've seen that if we have, for example, a tensor mu alpha beta, right? We have seen that this is a tensor mu alpha beta. So the partial derivative is going to send a vector of type, in this case, 2, 0, right? T is a 2-0 type, it's going to create a 2-1 vector, a tensor. So this is still a tensor, right? This is not anymore the case in a chord spacetime. If we are in a chord spacetime, we apply a derivative to a tensor, we don't get a tensor out. This is a problem. So the mu t alpha beta in curved space, not a tensor. And this is a problem. Because just think at the Poisson equation. We had that, right? Then we introduced special relativity, we introduced the box operator, which was fine, which was kind of better than before, but overall as a theory was failing because here we have something that is covariant and here we have something that is not covariant. And we were breaking. So now what we want to obtain is a covariant operator. The box operator was still based on partial derivatives, remember. Here you want a covariant operator that which is going to be applied to a tensor, give us another tensor. Something which is tensorial and which is covariant, and covariance on the other side as well. Covariant. And tensors are, of course, covariant, as we have seen several times by now. Okay? So that's the concept. We have a problem in moving from one point to another because we are dealing with different vector spaces as soon as we move. And the partial derivatives are not well behaving because in a curved space-time, when they are applied to a tensor, they do not give you another tensor. And this would make very difficult to construct a covariant theory, a fully covariant theory as we want. Okay? We want the theory to hold for any observer, no matter what is the frame. I show you why the partial derivatives are not a good operator. And this is kind of simple to say. I will prove. I will just take an example, but you can basically do the same for tensors with higher ranks. I will take an example, something simple, which is one of the simplest tensors that we can possibly have, which is a one-form. Okay? So I take a one-form that perhaps, well, it can belong to any vector space, let's just call it in a general way. It could be the tangent space, the dual of the tangent space, for instance. Okay? Any vector space is fine. So you see this is a type 0, 1 tensor. And now we want to see if we get a type 0, 2 tensor. How do we check that? Well, we look how it transforms. Okay? We have a tensor and we have an object. We don't know if it's a tensor. Once we apply the derivative, we want to see if the transformed object behaves as a tensor, obeys the transformation rules of tensors that we have seen in the previous lectures. Therefore, let's apply our derivatives. I use the E prime, W E prime. No, sorry, W prime. Let's go for the components. Okay, so I apply my derivative, transformed. So I just apply the transformation to the two objects. Therefore, I have dx e, dx e prime, which is the transformation for that, the e. Okay, then we have this guy transformed. Therefore, we're going to have the j, the x, j prime, w, j. Just apply the transformation, right? Which is a generic transformation. Then what we have? Well, we just apply this guy. I just keep it in front without touching it, and apply this operator to this object, and you see that we have a product here. Therefore, I need to apply the product rule of derivatives. Operator, product, product rule. So I have my operator, the xe over the xe prime. The e applied only to this guy here. Let me write it explicitly. The over the xe applied to the xj, the xj prime, times our vector wj, plus our operator again, the x e over the x e prime that I'm not touching. Now I have the delta applied to the other side. So we have the x j over the x j prime, which is this guy, times d over d x e apply to w j. Okay? This is good. This is exactly the transformation of a tensor of rank 0, 1. So this behaves well. This one is of too much, so to say. Okay? Too much unless this term is zero for some reason. And what could be the reason? Is that we are dealing with a linear transformation. If the transformation is constant, for example, across the space-time, if it's a linear transformation, its derivative will give you a zero. Okay? But in general, that's what we are dealing with, this is different than zero, and therefore this object doesn't operate as a tensor because on top of the good part there is this additional term. So the overall transformation is not the one of a tensor. Ok? This is an important piece of motivation. That's why we are going to do what we are going to do, which is to first define the affine connection and then define a covariant derivative. And the two things are kind of going together, they're kind of paired together. Okay? Good. Perhaps we can have the break here so that we start all in a blow afterward. But here I just want to give you a little summary. So you see that we arrived at defining the tangent spaces. We know how to define vectors on manifolds with all the mathematical infrastructures that we derived. We then, and up to this point, we never spoke about a metric. Okay? Now we introduce a metric such that we can deal with Riemannian geometry, or pseudo-Riemannian geometry. And we've seen that locally, as we've seen, we can have always a transformation such that we get the Minkowski metric in a very determined position. We can do it for every position in the space-time. And in the proximity, we can approximate a flat space in that location. With the radius, which is not kind of the same all over across the universe, but it depends on the distortion of the space-time that is taking place locally in the point that you are studying. Okay? Therefore, we need to define here, introduced a curvature radius, which is related to second derivatives of the metric. And why we are using second derivative, you know from here, because we are measuring how relevant are the tidal forces in a vicinity of a certain point. And of course, if the curvature is going to be very high, meaning the curvature radius is small, so the change is occurring on very small radiuses, on very small distances, the elevator in which we want to have our Minkowski space have to be very small. Okay? Therefore, according to the space-time, you need to have a good approximation for the metric to be Minkowski or almost Minkowski, depends on the space-time. Then, last bit, point six, is that we don't know how to relate vectors belonging to different vector spaces. We don't know how to deal with vectors that are belonging to vector spaces next one to each other. Okay? So we are going to then introduce the affine connection, which makes the business. Affine connection, which then can also be used to cure the problem that we have with partial derivatives, because as I've proven here, partial derivatives are not good operators if we want to construct a fully covariant theory. Because whenever we apply a derivative to a tensor, we do not get a tensor because the derivative is not transforming a tensor into another tensor. Okay, there is not this nice jump, because if we look at the transformation, there is a term which is not vanishing whenever we deal with the nonlinear transformations. Okay? Good. So we can have a 10-minute break. So if we manage, we finish a little bit earlier. So at 10 past 10. Ah, sorry, guys. There is an announcement. Because on Monday, there is going to be, you see at this location, so here at the INF building, 226 and 227, there is going to be this messe in which the various research groups in Heidelberg are going to present their research. And if you're interested into theses or, some project you would like to work on during your studies, also to acquire points, you can go there and see what Heidelberg is offering to you for your science and to play a little bit with some scientific tool. Okay, so take it. It's interesting also to learn stuff even if you're not going to do the project. So I encourage you to take part. Okay, good. So in 10 minutes.